That Bible study starts this Thursday, April the 6th. If you'd like more information on that, there's a sign-up sheet in the back hallway, and the ladies would love for you to participate with them. A couple of things going on the first Sunday of the month, so we have our newsletter out. Once again, on the front of the newsletter, you see the need for the restroom facility that we're going to be putting across the way. If you come and join us this afternoon from 4 to 6, you can even see where that would be and how that would sit out there and how well it would serve us as a church to have something like that available. So I hope you'll plan to join us. Some of you have said you'll come early about 2:30 or so and do some help in setting up. And I think we've about got that group lined up. So thank you all very much for that. And we'll have a great time this afternoon. If you would, please enter off of Riley Road, okay? Drive down Knight Avenue right next to the storage sheds and enter on Riley Road. There are some people that live down that road, so respect their residences, if you will, as you drive by slowly. And you'll see where to park down there, and we'll look forward to that. We're going to close off the access on for the dam side over here so that the kids can run and play. So if you try to come from this side over here, you're going to walk a good ways to get over there. So you're welcome to do that, but that's what's going to happen this afternoon, 4 to 6, egg hunt for the children up to 5th grade, some games that we'll have out there to play. We'll have hamburgers and hot dogs and whatever else you guys bring with you. That's what we'll have. And so we'll have a good time together as a church this afternoon. A few other things that are happening: the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. We'll say more about that in just a few minutes. The ladies Bible study, you just saw the information about that. In 3 weeks, on Sunday, we will have a spaghetti luncheon. That's to allow for some donations for youth camp. If you'd like to be a part of that, we'll have some more information coming up as well. If you have a graduate that would like to be recognized, please let Miss Cindy or myself know so that we can get that information there and that we can all do that together. So we are here to celebrate today. We're here to rejoice today. It is Palm Sunday, the Sunday prior to Resurrection Sunday. So we are excited to sing about our Savior's love for us. So Brother Mike, if you will, come and lead us.
Absolutely. And bring your lawn chair this afternoon. And remember, once again, Lisa, drive slow on Riley Road. Okay, so let's stand up together. Let's praise our Lord. We've got music picked out that tells us how much God give for us today. He came to live a perfect life. He came to be
the living word, our light. He came to die so we'd be reconciled. He came to rise to show his power and might. That's why we praise him. That's why we sing. That's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this King. 'Cause he gave his everything. 'Cause he gave his everything.
Listen to the words.
He came to live again in us. He came to be our conquering King and friend. He came to heal and show the lost ones his love. He came to go prepare a place for us. That's why we praise him. That's why we sing. That's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this King. 'Cause he gave his everything. 'Cause he gave his everything. Why we sing. That's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this King. 'Cause he gave his everything. 'Cause he gave his everything.
Amen. He's the perfect sacrifice, the perfect lamb.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. That's why we praise him. That's why we sing. 'cause he gave his everything. That's why we praise him. That's why we sing. That's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this king. 'Cause he gave his everything. 'Cause he gave his everything. Jesus gave us everything.
Amen. I like to change the words at the end. He gave us. Jesus gave us everything. Let's continue singing as we're remembering today the cross.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith that I see by sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I had done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross, at the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Amen. Thank you for coming as you are and worshiping our Lord today. I'm going to encourage you to stay standing as we honor him with the reading of his word. We're going to go to the 1 John chapter 4 and read together verses 9 and 10. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his one and only Son into the world so that we might live through him. Love consists in this: not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins, my sins and your sins. Amen. God bless you for being here today. You may be seated.
If you remember, through the month of April, we're doing an emphasis for the Annie Armstrong offering, and you've seen some of those flyers in the seats. You're welcome to grab one if you like. But let me read to you today's emphasis that Brother Clint has for us, and it's in that flyer. It says, today's Annie Armstrong reading is about Virgil and Kelsey Brown. They are church planters in Portland, Oregon. Oregon is considered one of the least church states in the nations. The Browns began one church, which they led for 10 years, and now God has led them to begin a second church. They and their children moved into a different part of the city, Portland, Oregon, where Christians are considered an oddity. They began an in-home prayer group, which has now become a church and is growing. They plan to plant other churches there in Portland, Oregon as well, and our support helps them. So, Brother Freddie, if you'll come lead us in prayer.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you because today is the day, the Lord, we have set aside to come to worship you. But Lord, we don't need to set it just for today. We need to worship you every day. We need to praise you every day because, Lord, you have blessed us. You keep us safe. Lord, you take care of us. Lord, all that, Lord, we know that we have been blessed by being a child of yours. Lord, I pray today, Lord, today would be the day for anyone that's here that don't know the Lord as a personal Savior or have never claimed it or asked, Lord, that the day would be the day that they would do that. They would not leave here without knowing that they can and they should be the one that comes forward. We ask you, Lord, to bless us today as we partake of the music, Lord, and more than that, Lord, you have blessed us, Lord, with a good services start with today. We ask you, Lord, to continue to bless us. And Lord, as we go into the part to the Lord's Supper, Lord, we ask you, Lord, to bless us through that also. We ask you, Lord, just to, as Daniel stands up here and he brings a message that, Lord, that you'll have him to, Lord, to bring, you know, the word that we need to hear. And we ask you, Lord, as he brings it, that we will open our hearts, we'll open our ears to hear what he's got for us. We ask it in the name of Christ. Amen.
Yeah.
you know, you might not know the whole story, and you're here today. What is Calvary, and what's this about the precious lamb, the perfect sacrifice? So we're going to continue praising him, and we're going to pray that the word of God will permeate in your heart and become clearer and clearer as the words preach and as the music is sung. So let's stand back together and let's sing about the cross, down at the cross. Listen to the story.
Down at the cross where my Savior died, downward for cleansing from sin I cried. There to my heart was the blood of life. Glory to his name, glory to his name, glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. I am so wondrously saved from sin. Jesus so sweetly abides within.
Thank you for praising him with me. And you may be seated, and the choir is going to exit. Children, you have an opportunity to head out on this next song for children's worship. You have a wonderful time learning about our Lord and Savior in children's worship opportunity.
Thank you, Brother Mike, and our orchestra. Thank you all for leading us. If you will, take your Bibles and turn, first of all, to the book of John. We'll be in John chapter 12 just for a few moments, and then we're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Several months ago, when we set this as a date to celebrate the Lord's Supper, started thinking about Palm Sunday and the Lord's Supper on Palm Sunday and maybe some of the significance of that, and then As I began to plan a few weeks ago to preach a series on gratitude, I began to think of how those things would come together. And so 2 weeks ago, we talked about gratitude, and we looked at the story of the 10 lepers who were healed, and only one returned to thank Jesus. And we're reminded by that in Scripture that, in reality, one of the things about gratitude is you have to exercise it. You got to put some effort into it. You got to put your feet to the walking, and your hands have got to go to the work. And so for this gentleman, that leper that day, he was present in his life and what had happened. And the challenge is so often we just want to hurry through this and hurry through that and forget about this and forget about that. And we're not present in the circumstances of our lives. And so that was a challenge for us. And then as I looked at gratitude, last week we looked at the story of Naaman and a guy who, if anybody could make the claim that he was a self-made man, it said he was a good general. He was good at what he did. And what he was good at was enslaving and entrapping the Israelites. And yet, who freed him from the bondage of his skin condition? A slave girl that worked for his wife, a prophet who could not be maneuvered or controlled by anyone, and his personal slaves who said, please do what the man of God has asked you to do. And the reality of it is there, we see in our lives in gratitude, not only do we have to be present in our circumstances, but we cannot succumb to the myth that we have created this situation that we're in. Paul even says nobody has except it's been given to them. So today as we look at Palm Sunday and we look at gratitude, while I won't mention it much, I want us to think about it in the context of community. Because as we celebrate the Lord's Supper today, that is what we are doing. We're doing it in the context of community. As a group of believers, some we know very well, some we don't know well at all. And then this has multiplied the world over. Right as the service was about to start, the three-year-old said, what is that? He wanted to know what was happening up here. He's seen it before, but life changes. He notices different things. And so we came up here and picked up the cloth and let him just quickly see underneath. And then his mother said to me, well, you explain it to him. So I did. The same way every Sunday school teacher has probably done it for many years. I said, it's a party. Because that's what it is. It is a celebration of what Jesus has done for us. And we have parties in the context of community, in the context of others. And so what a beautiful thought, because here on Palm Sunday in John chapter 12, let's read this passage of Scripture. Beginning at verse 9, it says this. Meanwhile, a large crowd of Jews found out that Jesus was there. He's in Bethany, and came, not only because of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to kill Lazarus as well, for on account of him, many of the Jews were going over to Jesus and believing in him. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the festival heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, as it is written, Do not be afraid, daughter Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt. At first, his disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him and that these things had been done to him. Turn, if you will, to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. We're going to look at verses 1 through 17, and then in a few moments as we celebrate the Lord's Supper together, we'll read verses 23 through 25. But the book of 1 Corinthians is a challenging book, and I know there's so much reading you could do just on this passage alone. And I attempted to do some of that over the last couple of weeks, specifically even this week. But there's so much that you could read there. And so as I thought about this, I thought, what am I seeing here? What is speaking to me? Paul in this book switches back and forth. At one point, he's condemning. Come on, guys, get your act together. Everybody knows better than this. Everybody's looking at you. And then at another point, he's commending them. You guys are doing wonderful. Look at you all. Look at the diversity within your church. Look at you all. So he's condemning and commending them back and forth. The church at Corinth, they see their dirty laundry aired for everyone to see as Paul writes this to them. But they're also encouraged because Paul calls them what? Co-workers. laborers in Christ. Paul writes them a letter that everybody gets to read and says, get your act together. Everybody can see what you're doing. And then he says, you're my co-laborers in Christ. So he condemns and he commends. He's back and forth as he deals with these people. He is at times the correcting father and the encouraging friend, oftentimes within just a few short sentences of each other. But through this, at least in the first couple of chapters, there emerges at least one theme that I want us to look at today, and it's this. Paul was invested in ensuring that the church in Corinth grew as a body. And a body grows one way, together. Paul says this. I'm just going to read a couple of verses throughout, and then we'll get to chapter 10. Chapter 1, verse 10. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters. Verse 11 of the same chapter. My brothers and sisters. Verse 26 of the same chapter. Brothers and sisters. Chapter 2 and verse 1. And so it was with me, brothers and sisters. Paul is drawing them together. He is referring to everyone that is there. Brother, sister, brother, sister. He is building this view that they are a body together. Chapter 3, verse 1, brothers and sisters. Chapter 4, verse 6, now, brothers and sisters. Chapter 4, verse 14, my dear children. Chapter 4, verse 15, I became your father. So Paul is building this community, this idea of community. And so we're going to be in chapter 10 today, and I'm going to read to you the focal point, and then we're going to go back and read the verses prior to that to have an understanding of what is happening in this passage. Beginning at verse 14, Paul says this, therefore, my dear friends, flee from idolatry. I speak to sensible people. Judge for yourselves what I say. Is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all share the one loaf. We see this as gratitude together. And then go back in verse 1 and see what Paul is comparing them to. So Paul doesn't just tell them that they're a community. He now illustrates to them how they are a community of believers. And he takes them all the way back to the Israelites as they left Egypt. He says this, for I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud and that they all passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank from the same spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them. Their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Now these things occurred as examples to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things as they did. Do not be idolaters, as some of them were, as it is written. The people sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. We should not commit sexual immorality, as some of them did, and as some of them did and were killed. In one day, 23,000 of them died. We should not test Christ, as some of them did, and were killed by snakes. And do not grumble, as some of them did, and were killed by the destroying angel. These things happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings for us, on whom the culmination of the ages has come. So if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind, and God is faithful. He will not let you to be tempted beyond what you can bear, but when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. John Phillips, in his commentary, notes that as God moved the children of Israel out of Egypt, that when Pharaoh's army began to follow them, God took the cloud which was preceding the children of Israel and put it on the other side of them and put it between them and Pharaoh's army. And he says this, thus God took the newly saved people and made them his own. He flung the mantle of his protection over them and led them onto the Red Sea. Now here's the line that I have all of this written down for. Such is salvation. It is all of grace and all of God. He will accept even the feeblest and most faltering faith. When we think about community, one of the things that generally begins to happen is we begin to segregate. We say, well, this is my group, and they're part of my group, but they're not really a part of my group. They are there, but and what we're trying to do very quietly, sometimes very nobly, is exalt ourselves and diminish others. At least that's what I find myself doing when I find myself doing that. I find that what I'm trying to do is say that I'm a little bit different than them, and therefore somewhere on some scale I should measure a little better, a little higher, a little bit more consistent, if you will, in my understanding. But Paul compares the community in Corinth, a community that he absolutely calls out on some things, with the community which exited Egypt. In fact, he says, our ancestors. Now, he's writing to a group of people. They're not all Jews, so they're not technically their physical ancestors, but they're their ancestors in faith. All are the children of Abraham. If you're a child of faith, you're a child of Abraham. And so here's what he tells them. All of our ancestors were all under the cloud. What is the cloud? Well, there was this glorious, mysterious thing that God did as he took the children of Israel out of Egypt, and this cloud preceded them in the daytime, and at night it was a fire. And so as this thing happened, guess who saw that in the camp? Every single person in the camp. It was not exempt to only the ones who were just willing to do it. Only the ones. So here's this cloud preceding them, and he puts it there. Then he says this, all of our ancestors passed through the sea. How many were able to actually leave Egypt and get out of it? Paul reminds us that they all did. Not just the ones who were acting good, not just the ones that were helping Moses, not just the ones who were better than everybody else, not the ones who had their tents packed on time, not the ones who had, if they had any animals, they had their animals under control, not the ones whose children just walked in a nice straight line. I don't know what that's like anymore. Not those ones. All of them. They all passed through the Red Sea. You and I are now being compared to that because we are recipients of this letter that he wrote to Corinth. We'll see more of that. He says, all of our ancestors were baptized into Moses in the cloud. Moses is a picture of Christ as he leads them out of Egypt. Jesus Christ is leading us out of our selfishness, our sinfulness, our commitment to self above all things. And we're all baptized by him, into him, as he leads us out of Egypt. He says, our ancestors are all baptized into the sea. Moses is a picture of Christ. He separates them. Christ separates them from Egypt. What they would not do on their own, he does for them. What they would not have eventually probably decided to do, he does for them. And how does he do it for them? He separates the water. You know, there's things that you and I would do that we just won't do, isn't there? And we just can't ever get around to doing it. And we just can't stop it. But maybe sometimes God separates the water for us. Paul goes on to say, all of our ancestors ate the spiritual food. Manna sent from heaven. Nothing they did to produce it. As John Phillips says, it's all of grace. It's either all of grace and all of God, or it's all of us and all of ourselves. And it cannot be both. All of our ancestors drank from the rock. The miracles of water that the Israelites experienced in the desert were a constant reminder of God's presence and ability. The same singular rock did not follow them, but the same behavior did. That in a dry place where there was no water, God would provide water. And in a dry place in our lives where there is no water, God, through Christ, provides that water. He is the living water. Paul notes that the Israelites were plagued by the same issues that the church of Corinth faced. Now he turns it on its head. He talks about how their faith and how God led them. And then he turns around and says, hey, by the way, you guys are struggling with this. They struggle with the same thing. They had three issues that I'm going to just quickly point out. Idolatry, immorality, and they were absolutely unsatisfied. The idolatry was this. You have to have something to worship. Every single one of us has to have a point of focus. And when the Israelites came out of Egypt, Moses goes up onto Mount Sinai. He's up there for an extended period of time. The people come to Aaron and they say, we got to have some focus, Aaron. You got to do something for us. You got to give us a picture of this God. Moses isn't here. We don't have Moses anymore. And so Aaron takes it and he forms something. And you know, it's been several thousand years since Aaron formed something, but you know, we still form our own idols. Maybe it's finances. Maybe it's politics. Maybe it's power. Maybe it's authority. We're convinced that if we just get the things wrapped up and in the shape that they're in and present them the right way, everything will work out. And so Aaron takes their gold and he forms their gold into this bull calf. The bull calf more than likely looked like the Egyptian god Apis, which was also a bull. The problem wasn't necessarily the image of the calf, but the idea that they had made it out of Egypt on their own ability and power, and not on God's ability and power. And I don't know about you, but every now and then I look back in my life and say, well, look what I did. Look where I'm at. And I miss the community that God has surrounded me with and the people that are a part of that. Not only were they had a problem with idolatry, they had a problem with immorality. You may remember the story of the talking donkey. Balaam's donkey tried to prohibit him from getting killed when he was going to Balak. Balaam stands in front of Balak, and Balak pays him money to curse the children of Israel. And if I remember the story correctly, and I did not write it down here, but three times he stood up to curse them, and three times he blessed them. Balak said, I've paid you money. You better perform. Balaam said, I can't curse them. I just can't curse them. He said, but I'll tell you what to do. He said, if you want to distract them, throw a party. Everybody likes parties. We do too. I mentioned that earlier. But have in mind that your party distract them from worshiping their God and tie them to worshiping our gods. Convince them that the good time that they're having is because of our God. And by the way, folks, you can take that and fast forward as many years as you want, and however many more years this earth is here, the same truth is still going to be there. Have a party, convince them that the fun that they're having is based on the power of that God, G-O-D, small g, whatever it is, money, whatever, pleasure, whatever. Convince them that that's what's bringing them their happiness, and they'll turn from their God. It's known as the curse of Balaam, and there it was true, and it worked. The problem wasn't necessarily the party, but that they changed their behaviors and began worshiping Baal. Because here's why they worshiped Baal. Baal was more fulfilling. Baal gave them the desires that they wanted when they wanted them. This God that they had followed out of Egypt, he didn't give them everything they wanted when they wanted it. He didn't allow them to consistently just do whatever they wanted, but Baal did, so they said, hey, let's go with Baal. Lastly, they were unsatisfied. And the story of the serpents is that story of their lack of satisfaction. But what does this mean to us? Well, it means this. Paul tells us that the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks and the bread that we break, this is a celebration. No longer do we look for a man, woman, or some other form of item or some being to stand between us and God. Jesus, who is God, has come, and in him we celebrate and live. We are like the Israelites. We are called out and brought out by God through the cloud, through this mystery that we don't even fully understand. We have crossed the sea, the dependence upon man to the dependence upon him. I can't imagine what it was like for the Israelites to walk through that watery place where the water was on each side. I cannot imagine what went through their minds, but they had to realize that there was no going back. And the same call goes out to you and I. Will we be dependent on God, or will we be dependent upon man? We are traversing this wilderness, tested by whether or not we believe Canaan is real. This kingdom of God that Jesus speaks about, where the lame walk and the blind see. This kingdom of God where the outsiders are welcomed and seen as powerful. This kingdom of God that you and I have the opportunity each day to step into the middle of it and experience it. And understand that yes, we long for heaven, and yes, we long for the presence of God, but God has promised his kingdom here and now among us, even today. It is this community of Christ. So when we meet here together on this Palm Sunday, we do not stand individually based on our merit, but rather on the merit of Christ. And that applies to every single person here. When we stand here together today on this Palm Sunday, we do not stand individually based on how distinct and able we are, but rather we become part of a crowd. And we become part of a crowd that took up palm branches and preceded him into the city, celebrating and praising God. To some degree, our self-identity is taken away from us because we join a group of people who are waving palm branches. And you have to know in the group of palm branch waving people, there were some people in there that were doing it purely to spite the Romans. There's thousands of us. They can't get us all. I'm jumping in this crowd. Maybe there's people that did it because their cousin was doing it, their aunt was doing it, their friend was doing it. Maybe some were doing it because Jesus had healed them, or they knew someone that Jesus had healed. But when we join the crowd of people, we lose that self-identity that somehow usually permeates our lives. And we become celebrants in this community. When we take our communion today, we know that there is far more beyond what we can see. But we also know that what we can see is enough to challenge us. As this crowd of people waved palm branches and marched into the city in front of Jesus, you would have had those who disliked each other, those who were at disagreement, and yet in their worship of Jesus, they transcended what they did not even know. We too today do this together as we take of the bread, which is a picture of the body of Christ, the life that was given for us. We too are waving our palm branches alongside those with whom we may struggle to understand or agree with. We too are participating in the redemptive work of Christ. We are many, but we share one loaf, the person of Jesus Christ. No, you may not stand in the street today and wave palm branches. You may if you choose. But in just a moment, we're going to take a small piece of bread and a small cup of juice. And we're going to say, I'm part of the crowd that believes that Jesus is my Savior. I'm going to pray, and as I pray, Lisa's going to come to play the piano, and Brother Mike's going to be coming, and our deacons who are going to lead us in service, we'll ask that they come at this time as well. God, this service is a celebration. It's a celebration of your faithfulness. It's a celebration of your goodness. It's a celebration of your presence in our lives. Lord, you don't just promise to be with us, but you actually are with us. And you present yourself here with us even today. God, we are a diverse group of people, each one of us here with our needs, our concerns, our ideas, our plans. But in all of those, you are God. And so as we as a community take this Lord's Supper in just a moment, we commit ourselves to you. And we become like that group in front of you so many years before, waving palm branches and saying, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Gentlemen, if you would. Paul, just a few short verses after he made this proclamation that you are one body. After he makes his proclamation, he gives them the instructions for how they should follow the taking of the Lord's Supper. And he says this, for I received the Lord Jesus, which I also passed on to you. So this is his promise to us. So we'll first take of the bread, and then we'll take of the cup. So as we do so, I'd ask, Brother Freddie, will you pray and thank God for the bread, which is in memory of Jesus' blood.
Lord, we do thank you because we can come together. We have that privilege and that honor to do this and to thank you, Lord, for the body that you have given us, Lord, and through that, Lord, that you have fulfilled and done the things we need to do. We thank you for the body. We ask you, Lord, for your praise upon it in Christ's name.
Amen. Paul states in Scripture what Jesus had stated. He says this, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Scripture tells us that after that they took the cup. So I ask Brother Van, will you give thanks for the cup?
Heavenly Father, thank you so much for allowing us. In fact, you ask us to do this in remembrance of you for what you did for us. Thank you so much for also asking the Father to send the Holy Spirit in your absence whenever you went back to heaven. Thank you for the blood that you spilt, for it cleanses us of our sin. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. White as snow.